I want to be good in the akhirah. It starts here with the mujahada. This hadith عن أبي فراس ربيعة ابن كعب الأسلمي خادم رسول الله خادم رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ومن أهل الصفة رضي الله عنه قال كنت أبيت مع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فآتيه بوضوئه وحاجته فقال صلى الله عليه وسلم سلني يعني بيقول ربيعة سلني اطلب اللي انت عايزه فقلت أسألك مرافقتك في الجنة فقال أو غير ذلك في شيء تاني قلت هو ذاك بس ده قلت هو ذا قال فأعني على نفسك بكثرة السجود حديث صحيح مسلم this حديث أبو فراس ربيعة بن كعب الأسلمي ربيعة بن كعب الأسلمي ده صحابي في رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم his كنية is أبو فراس his كنية is أبو فراس and his name is ربيعة بن كعب الأسلمي he was a خادم of رسول الله so among those who served رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يعني خادم is not a slave he's a free man like أنس بن مالك رضي الله عنه خادم and that's an honor to be a خادم of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So they used to do that with, to be closer to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Like Umm Sulaym bint Milhan radiallahu anha, the mother of Anas ibn Malik, she comes to Rasulullah and said, "Ya Rasulullah, this is your khuwaidim Anas. Khadim is a servant. Khuwaidim and little servant. This is your servant, minor servant. يعني to you, Rasulullah. So he served Rasulullah for 10 years." Until Rasulullah passed away. From the time he came to Medina, he became the servant of Rasulullah. But after that, what is the blessing of being a servant of Rasulullah? To be Anas ibn Malik. To get the dua of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah give him long life. He lives until he become like 120 years old or something. That Allah give him rizq more than anyone else. That Allah give him more children. Give him more children. Because he served Rasulullah. So Rabi' al-Aslami was like that. And he was a very poor person. So he was among the people of As-Suffa. Suffa is a place made in the Masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Used to be the end of the Masjid of Rasulullah for those poor people who don't have income or who don't have but they dedicated their life to serve and learn from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. To serve and learn from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This Ahl al-Suffa after Rasulullah started working and traveling and going for jihad and doing all of these kind of things. But while Rasulullah was alive, they were staying at the masjid, like a dedicated student of knowledge. So they will serve Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they will sit and write the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they will ask him questions and he will ask them to do certain things and they were close to Rasulullah. So he is narrating one of his encounters or experience with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. So he says, Kuntu abitu ma Rasulillah. Kuntu abitu ma Rasulillah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Among the adults, Ahl al-Suffa, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud was there, Abu Huraira was there, يعني in the beginning. يعني. So this is the Sahaba of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, I used to spend the night with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, sometimes in the masjid, sometimes, you know, in another place, but he's with Rasulullah, around Rasulullah. So he said, I used to bring him al-wadu, al-wadu, wadu, not wu. Wu is the act, wa is the water. So wadu, يعني the water that he will make wadu with. So wudu is what you make wudu with. This is in, yeah, in Arabic is like that. Yeah, so when you say wudu, I am doing wudu. Wudu is the water that you are using for wudu, right? Tuhur is the action of purification. Tahur is what you purify yourself with, okay? So fu'ul wa fa'ul in Arabic is giving us this kind of, you know, sense here. Fa'ul is the act. Fa'ul is what you do that act. The wazn, يعني, right? So tahur, wa tuhur, wudu wa wudu. Alright, so he said فكنت أتيه كنت أبيت مع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فأتيه يعني I bring him بوضوئه يعني it's time for wudu, so he brings the wudu to رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. وحاجته, he did not say what حاجة here. حاجة يعني need. This حاجة is different thing. So anything he needs, yeah. So I'll bring him the wudu, I'll bring him the suwak maybe, I'll bring him something, you know, that he needs with that. So one day he told me, and he's saying, I'll bring him that. فَقَالَ سَلْنِي سَلْنِي Ask me, do you need something? Why? Because he wants to reward him. So he told him, I want to be with you in Jannah. مرافقتك في الجنة. He did not say, I want to enter Jannah. I'll be with you. You know, I'm here, your Rafiq here, يعني your صاحب here, your companion here, but I want to be like that in Jannah too. سبحان الله. Imagine the question, you know, like someone ask me whatever you want. Well, I like to have groceries for 1 year. I'd like to have a nice car. I'd like to have this and I'd like to have that. And he's sitting in a sofa. I'd like to have a house. مثلاً يعني, give me a ride, camel, مثلاً. Like, سألني. He asked him a question. Wallahi, if he asked Rasulullah anything, he would have given him. I want a camel, I want a wife, I want like something like that. I want a house and a wife to start a family. I want a camel to ride. I want to do things like that. He said, "La, Jannah. And not any Jannah. I will be with you in Jannah." So Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, "Yeah, other things. Anything else? أو غير ذلك. أو غير ذلك. يعني, okay, we'll talk about that, but دنيا يعني دنيا. أو غير ذلك. قال هو ذاك." See the insisting, he said, not that, this one. Clear vision. What do you call this? Clear vision. It does not, is not distracted. You know, sometimes we say, are you sure? Then, think a little bit, right? No, I am sure. So, أَوَغَيْرَ ذَلِكَ What else? هُوَ ذَاكَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ But that's it. SubhanAllah, someone living all his life for that goal. He's seeing Rasulullah in front of him every day, and he does not want to quit that. He wants this forever. So Rasulullah said, if it is like that, then help me to achieve this by making more and more sujood. That is what will get you to be my companion in Al-Jannah. A'inni. You see A'inni? A'inni means give me awn. Awn. A'ana yu'inu awnan. Right? Awn. يعني, so help me. Like ذو القرنين, he told the people, فأعينوني بقوة. When you want عون, you give عون, real عون, help. So he said, you want to achieve that? You have to help me to help you to achieve that by making more sujood. Rasulullah is telling him, I can't do it on my own, making dua for you. And he can say, Ya Allah, make Rabi'a my companion in Jannah. خلاص. Right? But he told him, you get it. That's what it means, right? You're going to get that. But there is a package. Yeah. There is a way, mujahada. You have to make more sajda. More sajda, more qiyam, means more salah, means more tahajjud, means more nafil. So when you want that big of a goal, you have to do that much of an effort. See the hadith now? Yeah, you can aim high, but you have to work hard. You want to go to Jannah, there is a level of mujahada. You want to go to Firdaus al-A'la, there is another level of mujahada. You want to be the companion of Rasulullah in Jannah, there is a higher level of mujahada. من طلب العلا سهر الليالي. Who wants to be number one? He has to spend the night studying and praying and doing other things. So it's not by wishing. When you just wish, it's not a goal anymore, it's just a wish. A goal without effort is just a wish. Is that clear? Just a wish. It's just a wish. You cannot set a goal and don't work for it. You can't set a goal and work for it. I want to be fit. I want to be fit. But mashallah, every day, كله ما شاء الله يعني المحشي والبرياني والكورنة وكير و this is sweet و this is appetizer و how do you fit ما شاء الله. And then you know when it comes to work, sleeping in the couch. Work, start somewhere. So we cannot be fit while you're not working for it. You cannot be healthy while you're not working for it. You cannot be a good believer while you're not working for it. You cannot achieve the highest degree in Jannah while you're not working for it. You cannot be reading Quran properly while you're not working for it. See? You cannot have a good family while you're not working for it. You cannot have a loving wife while you're not working for it. You cannot make your husband love you while you're not working for it. You cannot raise a family as good Muslims while you're not working for it. Exactly like you cannot make money without working for it. That part we good, mashallah. We know that one very well. You know, I cannot get money without having a job. This, it's a given. Yeah, people know it. I want to get money, I have to work for it. So everybody knows that one. Even little kids. Money, I have to do something. Dad, how are you? I love you so much. What you need? Right? So they have to work for it. So they know. Kids know, everybody knows how to get the money, how to get the benefit. We need to do that with Rabbul Alameen subhanahu wa ta'ala. We need to do that for our deen. You cannot have a perfect salah without working for it. Learn how. Now, so also in this hadith, subhanallah, we see how when somebody does ma'ruf to you, ma'ruf means something good, you need to reward them as well. If you can reward, you should reward the gift. So Rasulullah is asking him, ask me whatever you want. So when somebody is nice to you, you need to reward them. And this is a sunnah that we forget sometimes. Unfortunately, sometimes we feel entitled that people have to serve us. Yeah. Entitled as a father or as a mother or as an employer. Or as imam of a masjid, or as an administration of some type, or as a figure of authority. We think that people have to serve us. And if they don't serve us, we become offended. When you enter and people don't stand up for you and run toward you, we become offended. Why? You're a human being too. Respect is to be given, not to be taken. Right, uncle? Yeah. Respect, you get it when you deal with others with respect. Then they start respecting you. But if you demand it, it's not respect. It is more of fear. It's more of obligation. So it looks like respect, but it's not respect. Because once you are absent, no respect. When you go, no respect. So respect is not to be demanded. Respect is to be given. Respect is to be given. That's why there is a difference between a leader and a dictator. A leader is made leader. Dictator is appointed leader. Appoint himself, yeah. Right? Leader is the one who makes everyone around them worthy. You know, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he makes everybody around feel that they are the world, that they are better than anyone else. He makes them feel that. So a true leader is the one everybody feel empowered around, right? They want to be around. They wake up in the morning and they want to see that leader. They want to go around, you know, they feel energy coming from this guy. They want to be around, they want to serve, they want to do something. That is a leader. But when you find someone giving orders and people waking up in the morning expecting what's going to be the orders of today from the leader, in that sense, that's not a leader. The leader is the one who make people around leaders. So if he walks away, all of them become leaders in their own good. And that's what happened with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. True or not? True or not?
Yes.
A sahabi, you take one sahabi, he changed the world. One. Because they learned from a true leader, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. That's us now, inshallah. You become a leader, not by demanding respect, not by authority over people, no. By love of the people.
You have to earn it.
You have to earn it, thank you. You have to earn it, and whenever you go, you serve everybody. That's why everybody loves you, they want to serve you back. You serve 50 people, you get service from 50 people. You see, when you give everyone tiny things, 50 people. Each one of the 50 want to give you everything. That's smart. But you have to work for it. So leadership is something great. I'd advise you to go read on leadership, brothers, sisters. Read on leadership. What leadership means. In our time, the modern science and all that, they see the definition of leadership. A few days ago, there was a board of a masjid wanting advice. So I'm advising, and then they are complaining about micromanagement. Micromanagement. I see micromanagement, but micromanager is the last one who believes that he's a micromanager. All right? This is something known, yeah. So it's a waste of time to keep seeing you're a micromanager. It's a waste of time. Okay? So they need advice, and they say, micromanagement. No, it's not micromanagement. That is micromanagement. Okay, so instead of having another problem of childish debate, yani, right? So let's fix the issue. So we say, what are the signs of having micromanagement? Right? So just go to the pros. So very simple search will get you the Harvard Business Review, and it will tell you signs you are a micromanager. Those signs, if they are there, you are a micromanager. Halas, yani it's not me, not you, it's someone who knows this, right? And then you see all 5-6 signs, they are in there. So everybody looks at each other, well, I guess we are micromanagers. Yeah, let's know how to fix it now. How to fix it. Delegate. And you have to be comfortable with letting go. You have to. You have to be comfortable with letting go. You have to be comfortable with giving people a chance to err, to make mistake and learn from it. That happened with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Many times he sent the Sahaba, they do something wrong, and then he comes back and he teaches and all that for us to learn. But micromanager is the last one who believes that he's a micromanager. All right? This is something known. Yani. So it's a waste of time to keep seeing you're a micromanager. It's a waste of time. Okay? So they need advice, and they say, micromanagement. No, it's not micromanagement. That is micromanagement. Okay, so instead of having another problem of childish debate, yani, right? So let's fix the issue. So we say, what are the signs of having micromanagement? Right? So just go to the pros. So very simple search will get you the Harvard Business Review, and it will tell you signs you are a micromanager. Those signs, if they are there, you are a micromanager. Khalas. Yani it's not me, not you, it's someone who knows this, right? And then you see all 5-6 signs, they are in there. So everybody looks at each other, well, I guess we are micromanagers now. Yeah, let's know how to fix it now. How to fix it. Delegate. And you have to be comfortable with letting go. You have to. You have to be comfortable with letting go. You have to be comfortable with giving people a chance to err, to make mistake and learn from it. That happened with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Many times he sent the Sahaba, they do something wrong, and then he comes back and he teaches and all that for us to learn. But at the end, they're perfect. They become perfect leaders. That's how you do it. But if you say, I'm going to do it, it's not going to be done unless I do it, right? And these people will not know. It's a waste of my time. I have to show my self-worth. I have to bring... This is micromanagement. All right? So don't feel entitled because you have authority or something like that. So this is an issue. Sometimes we do things unintentionally, but we need to get to it. So read about leadership, brothers, please, and sisters. Please read about leadership and be humble enough to change yourself from inside. You know, I shared the story with you before. We all make mistakes, but we learn. We have the audacity, I mean, the courage to admit and to do the right thing, especially when you are not a professional in something.
admit that, you know, yeah, I want to learn. Subhanallah. You know, I told you before, I don't remember because I speak in too many places, but I don't remember if I said it here or not. I said, if you're looking for an imam, some people look for an imam, and they ask, can you help us for finding the imam? Imam committee, right? Which I do with another masjid also. So I tell them, they said, what is the criteria, the main criteria of an imam? What is the main criteria of the imam? Forget about the qualification. We're talking about criteria now. Like, what is the main aspect, right, of that imam that you want when he comes? What do you think would be? I'm asking you now. What do you think criteria? Like, first thing to look for when you are picking an imam to lead or someone to deal with the youth or something like that. What would be the first aspect? Education, that's qualification. What else? A good listener, very close. Leadership. All of these are good qualifications and prerequisite. But you see, you said good listener, you know? That is one aspect of wanting to learn. You know, my main criteria, if I'm going to choose someone to be with my children or with the youth, I want him to want to learn. If he comes with the perception that I'm going to be there to teach only, it's not good on the long run. You see, we all focus on how educated he is. Wallahi, for me, it doesn't matter. Yani, you know, decent education is enough. But I look at him 10 years from now, staying with the community, that he learned more. If he's open to learn about the community, he's going to teach them very well. You get it? So if someone comes and I have a package, I am the PhD in Usuluddin, whatever it is, right? And I'm coming here, I'm the big sheikh, you guys are my students. If that perception is there, 10 years from now, you don't go that far. You don't go that far. Look around you, and you'll know what I'm talking about. Look around you in the United States, all of North America, look around you. If there is just a big sheikh, education and all of that, what changes that they make in the community after years and years? But if someone who is willing to be dynamic and interact with the community and learn, ask questions, ask the youth, how you do these things? That's learning, right? When you ask, what is your struggle? Teach me. So they give him the feedback, right? So now he learns about the audience that he's teaching. What is going to happen? He's going to teach them better, design better. When I know you better, I know how to address you. Then when you sit, after you leave, you benefited something new. Because I'm learning about you. You are not only learning from me. I'm learning about you every day. Every time I sit with you, talk with you, I learn about you more. Don't just take things like it happens like that. When you stand and joke with someone or talk with someone or eat with someone, you're learning about them. You're learning about them. You're learning about their habits. When did they smile? When they do? And Rasulullah used to look like, to the Sahaba like that. He knows what's bothering them. He knows what is going on. So then the teachings comes customized. And that's a very beneficial teaching. It's not a standard. It's not one size fits all. It's customized. So when somebody asks him, Ya Rasulullah, give me nasiha, he said, La taghdab, don't be angry. He knows whom he's speaking to. He knows who. One advice fixes the situation. Subhanallah. So when you learn, more. So criteria is whenever you want somebody to teach your children, you want someone who is a good learner because he's going to be a good listener. He's going to be having ikhlas. He's going to have good education. It's not enough to have a certificate. I have ijazah this, I have certificate that. So what? So what? I want you, when you sit with the people, you learn from them and you teach them. The best teacher is the best learner. Best learner is the best teacher. Remember that. You know, teacher learns every day from his students or her students. More actually than he teaches. You know, you learn more and more and more and you say one thing only. When I enter my classroom, I know who's the joker. I know who's the tough. I know who's the leader. I know all this. This is learning for me. So when I say one word, that's it. Because I learned a lot. So when you are a good learner, you will become a good teacher. And you need to reward people, subhanAllah. You need to reward people. So a good leader is the one who rewards everybody around him. That's why I digressed in this section here. I told you before the explanation of the hadith is not to say this word means that thing. We have to relate to our life as well. That's why sometimes I move away from that. So Rasulullah used to reward people. Ka'b ibn Malik, when the Tawbah, you know the story of that, his Tawbah, when he did not go with Rasulullah to the battle, and then 40 days nobody was talking to them and all of that, and no salam, nothing. Him and Murar ibn Rabi' and Hilal ibn Umayyah, three Sahaba, yani, three good Sahaba, but they made the mistake. They did not go with Rasulullah with no excuse, and they admitted it. Not like the munafiqeen. They admitted and they waited for punishment, right? So punishment was from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, not to talk to them, their wives to stay away from them, and it was tough. At the end, the tawbah from Allah came, right? So they were sitting, they are not even with the jama'ah in the masjid, because they go to jama'ah, they are not welcome. They say salam, nobody answers. Even Rasulullah does not answer their salam. Can you imagine that? This is not a simple deal here. You know, you come here and if your friend looks at you and he moves away, Allah, you go home, you cannot sleep. But this is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he says, I go to the masjid, I say, assalamu alaikum, and I'm looking at the face of Rasulullah. Did he move his lips or not move his lips? It's very tough. To that level. So when the tawbah of Allah comes, it's something big, right? So he was sitting on the roof of his house crying. يعني ضاقت عليهم الأرض. Nobody wants to talk to them, nothing. خلاص, يعني death is bitter. And then he hears someone, Ya Ka'b ibn Malik, Abshir. Allah Azza wa Jal give you tawbah. So he makes sajda to Allah Azza wa Jal. And when the man comes to him, he took his garment, mantle, and he gave it to him. That's what I'm talking about, يعني why I'm quoting this. Mukafa'a. Mukafa'a means reward. He brought good news. Bearer of good news. The bearer of good news, you give them mukafa'a. And that's a sunnah. We don't do that. You know, if someone comes and they give you good news or make you happy, you should have something. Give them a pen, give them, you know, some perfume, something. Hadiyah, yeah. You know, this hadiyah is a sunnah. Hadu tahabbu. You know, give the hadiyah, become, you love each other. And when somebody does something good to you, you give them mukafa'a. Also, if you can help, you should ask people if you can help them. You know, I like it when you go to the store and they write, how can I help you? You know how I can help you? That's a big deal, by the way. It's a big deal. How may I help you? It's a big deal. It's not like a small motto or someone working there. No, they are offering help. You know what? Just reading that, you kind of feel relaxed, don't you? Even if you don't need help, you know that you can get help if you want it. Someone there, he already offered. But if nobody offers, can I ask him for help? Should I ask this one or this one? I'm afraid if I ask this one, he's not going to give me. You see? This is the game of risk here. But if someone that I know, when I enter the masjid, anyone sitting here may help me. You think I would be safe or I would be worried? Very safe. That is the community of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Anybody walking around, they know if they have a need, they'll get it. They will get the need, subhanAllah. Also, in this hadith, see the ulama talk about things that you can have a khadim who's not a slave. Yani before there was slavery, right? So slavery is like kind of humiliation, you know, there's servitude, there's things like that. But also a free man can work as a servant. And this had at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because the man, free man, had certain standards at that time compared to not a non-free man. So here in this hadith, the ulama said, a person can be free, yet he can serve someone. He can get paid or not get paid. So it's not a humiliation thing as here. It's a job. يعني. It is a job. um, Also, this hadith showed us that Rasulullah does not have the power to admit people to Jannah without Allah's permission. You want to be my friend in Jannah, you want to be my companion in Jannah, you have to make sajda to Allah. So, you know, a'inni, yani give me help by doing more sujood to who? To me? No, to Allah. So that means he's leading him, telling him, yes, you can be with me in Jannah. But how are you going to get it? From Rabbul Alameen, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, there is another hadith when one of the servants of Rasulullah was crying. And he tell him, why you cry? He said, Ya Rasulullah, you know, I'm used to see you every day. I'm used to see you every day. And I remember in the Yawm al-Qiyamah, you're going to be in Firdaus al-A'la, so I'm not going to be seeing you. You know, you are Rasulullah, you are going to be there in Firdaus al-A'la, and I have nobody, you know. So I want to be with you in Jannah. So he said, Al-mar'u ma'a man ahabba Yawm al-Qiyamah. You are going to be with whom you love. Yawm al-Qiyamah. That means put this hadith with that hadith, you will understand the point. So he tell him, you will be with whom you love Yawm al-Qiyamah. I told you he customized the advice. So this one, he told him, you need to do more sujood. The other one, he said, your love is so sincere, it will get you to be with me in Jannah. You see the, you know, he knows. So you have to be sincerely loving Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You have to be reflecting that sincere love in the following of the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and you have to augment all of this with more sujood to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you become with Rasulullah in al-Jannah. So you take from the advice in different places and you find the whole idea. You have to do your salah and you have to do the extras, mujahada. Your love has to be sincere to Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and it has to show in your actions, then you will be with whomever you love يوم القيامة. سبحان الله. The next hadith عن أبي عبد الله. That's another one. أبي عبد الرحمن أو أبو عبد الرحمن. His name is أبو عبد الله أو أبو عبد الرحمن. ثوبان مولى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. قال سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول عليك بكثرة السجود. فإنك لن تسجد لله ساجدة إلا رفعك الله بها درجة وحط عنك بها خطيئة. رواه مسلم. This is another servant of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. His name is ثوبان. ثوبان مولى. مولى يعني freed slave. مولى means freed slave. And this is one of the words that means that have a certain meaning and its opposite, both. So the word مولى means the one who is freed and the one who freed him, both مولى. Allahu مولانا. Allah is our مولى. And the servant is مولى too. So مولى here means the master and the freed slave, both. It depends on whom you are addressing within the context. So ثوبان is the مولى of Rasulullah. يعني Rasulullah freed him, but he continued to serve. Like Zayd ibn Haritha. He was slave of Khadija. He gifted him to Rasulullah. Rasulullah freed him, called him Zayd ibn Muhammad. And then after that, you know, adoption was abrogated, giving the name and all that. So he's Mawla. Mawla يعني was slave and freed. Most of the scholars of the Tabi'een are Mawali. Most of the scholars of the Tabi'een who carried the ilm of the Sahaba to the Ummah, they are freed slaves. All, most of them, freed slave or sons of freed slaves. You know, you will Ata ibn Abi Rabah, Hassan al-Basri, all the people. They were either freed slaves or the sons of freed slaves at the time of the Sahaba. The Tabi'een. Tabi'een means the followers, the students of the companions. Most of the scholars who were among the Tabi'een, the generation after the companions. Yeah. You know, there is Sahaba. Those who were the Rasulullah. Tabi'een, those who saw the Sahaba of Rasulullah. Yani Sahabi is the one who believed in Rasulullah, who saw him, and he died on the state of faith. Three conditions, right? So Sahabi is someone who accepted Islam at the time of, but he has to see Rasulullah. Even he was a baby, yani his eyes came in the eyes of Rasulullah. That's called Sahabi. It doesn't have to be like seeing, yani, you know, even a baby who was born at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and his face came in the face of Rasulullah, is called Sahabi as well. Last day before Rasulullah dies, if there was a baby born there and he saw the face of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he's a Sahabi. Right? And he believed, and he stayed, died on that belief, because munafiqeen, they saw Rasulullah. Yani Abu Jahl saw Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Does that make him a Sahabi? Why? Because he did not believe. Right? Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul, hypocrite. He saw Rasulullah. He said, I believe in him. But he did not die on that state. He did not live. So you have to know. Many people accepted Islam, but they did not see Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They are not called Sahabi. They called him Sahabi Mukhadram. Mukhadram means like he was at the time, but he did not see face to face. So those who believed in Rasulullah, but they did not meet him, they are not a Sahabi. That's a Sahabi. Tabi'in, same thing applies, that they saw the Sahabi of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they become Tabi'in. Tabi'in means they are followers of the Sahaba. Okay? So those Tabi'in, they were hundreds of thousands. Tabi'in, hundreds of thousands of people who were with the Sahaba, learning from the Sahaba, and all of that. But the scholars of the Tabi'in, yani after the Sahaba die, while the end of the Sahaba, some Tabi'in became prominent. Like, you know, those are the sheikhs of the time. Most of those, they were either freed slaves or the sons of freed slaves at the time of the Sahaba. Yani, the person is a freed slave of a Sahabi. Right? Freed slave of a Sahabi. Like Mujahid, wa Ikrima, wa Qatada. All of those are students of Abdullah ibn Abbas. Freed slaves. You see? So they were slaves. He freed them. They became his students, his servants, and the best students who carried the deen to the ummah after. So that shows you what Islam did with slavery. People talk about slavery and all of that. Yeah. So most of them is like this. To the point, one of the khalifas of Bani Umayyah one time, he said, who is the biggest scholar here? They keep telling him, such and such person. He said, from which family? He said, a free slave. And this one, from which family? He said, free slave. There is no free man here who is that scholar. Yani he was asking like this. To show the izzah of the deen is not who is from what tribe. Yani. It is who is carrying. Who you can ask and they can teach you about the deen, that's what matters. It is not which family and which, no, it's merit. Completely merit. You know, the Khalifa goes and he says, who is the scholar? He said, Ata ibn Abi Rabah. Ata ibn Abi Rabah, nobody beats him in the... He is the one mufti of the Hajj. And he will go to Hajj. Who is the mufti of the Hajj? Ata ibn Abi Rabah. This guy sitting over there. And his health was not that good. And he's alim, the scholar of the time. Khalas, you sit and you learn, Khalifa or no Khalifa. Yani. You're going to sit here, bend your knees and sit and ask him, Sheikh Saab, you know, what? How can I do this? That's it. Allah is the one who gives the level. You are the Khalifa, yes, he will respect you. He will obey you because you are Waliyul Amr, right? But when it comes to the deen, you sit and learn. That's our beautiful religion. Yes. So he told, he said, I heard from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying, telling him, yani, عليك بكثرة السجود. More sajda. Why? Because you will never make one sajda. لن تسجد لله. See, لله, that word لله is the key in the hadith. فإنك لن تسجد لله. Of course it is known. يعني the other one, he said, عليك بكثرة السجود. He did not say كثرة السجود لله. He did not say that word. Because it's understood, right? He's only كثرة السجود. Whom you going to make sujood? But here, he told him, فَإِنَّكَ لَن تَسْجُدَ سَجْدَ. No, he said, تَسْجُدَ لِلَّهِ سَجْدَ. So that is emphasis here. Yeah, it has to be sincere too. Allah, this is not sajda routine. You know routine, salah time, let's do namaz and go. Routine. No, you have to feel your head is down for Allah. Ya Rabb, Subhan Rabbi al-A'la, Subhan Rabbi al-A'la. You feel it. You feel that he's A'la and you're down here. He's A'la, subhanahu wa ta'ala. You're asking. So feel the sajda. Tasjuda lillahi sajda. Every sajda with that quality, rafa'aka Allahu biha daraja. Allah will increase higher degree. وحط عنك بها خطيئة. Who among us does not sin? We all do. So every sajda you do for Allah, Allah raises your rank higher and Allah wipes a sin. Every sajda, yeah. That means we let's do more sajdas, mashallah. Every time you want to do 2 rak'ah nafl, make them 4, inshallah. Can we do that, inshallah, Rabbil Alameen? Increase. Every time you do Subhana Rabbil A'la 3 times, inshallah, make them 5, 6, 7. Increase a little bit. Breathe while you are relaxed. So try to improve the quality and increase the quantity. Increase the quantity, then improve the quality, inshallah, Rabbil Alameen. Subhanallah, and this is blessing. But you will always make more sajdas. In every salah, you make more sajdas. Why? Because every rak'ah has 1 qiyam, 1 ruku', but 2 sujood. So every time you increase 1 rak'ah, you are actually increasing 2 sajdas. You see? So sujood actually will be, mashallah, more. And every sajda, you get that. What time is shuruq today? Already you have? So one more hadith, inshallah, we'll finish. The 14th hadith, hadith number 14 and 108 in this section. عن أبي صفوان عبد الله بن بصر الأسلامي. صحابي في رسول الله, his name is Abdullah ibn Busr. And his kunya is Abu Safwan. قال, he said, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, خير الناس من طال عمره وحسن عمله. The hadith I mentioned earlier. خير الناس, the best of people, من طال عمره who have a good life, وحسن عمله, and good deeds. So long life is not bad or good in its own. On its own. What does that mean here? It doesn't mean that I'm 60, 70, 80, 90 years old. That doesn't matter. What matters is, how old are you in action? Some people, they are 90 years old, but their amal is 2 years old. And some people 20 years old, but their amal is like 60 years old. You get the idea now. Right? So if you, as one of the shuyukh, mashallah, made a simple calculation one time, he said, if a person is 60 years old, and you sleep 8 hours a day, that's 1/3 of your life sleeping, mashallah. So 20 years out. 20 years already cut from your life. You are 60, so now you are 40 only. That feels good, huh? So you are 40 only. Because 20 years you are with Ahlul Kahf, يعني, with the people of the cave. And then another third, take another 15 years out when there is no takleef, يعني, child. No takleef. Another 15, gone out. So that's 35 years out of the 60. More than half of your life, nothing happens. And then you eat, you know, take another maybe 5 years of just eating and doing other things like that. Eating and doing drinking and dressing and, you know, getting ready, standing in front of the mirror and putting perfume and all these kind of things. Yeah. So that's 5 years out of the 60. So that means now, how many years now? 20 years gone? Huh? 20 is left. So 40 years out of the 60, gone. And then how much you work for the dunya? So where is the ibadah now? 20 years gone in the work and being busy making money. So where is the ibadah? Now you get the idea, right? So a 60-year-old and zero? How much ibadah you do every day? Calculate kida the, if somebody is only doing salah 5 times a day. 1 hour a day? Allahu Akbar, mashallah. So 30 minutes, if you do the 5 daily salah, 30 minutes a day. I know, uncle, I'm trying to make a point here.
if I live life,
Ahsant. Good. But we are talking about the dedicated ibadah. Because if without the dedicated ibadah, you cannot live all this life for the sake of Allah. You have to start with the ibadah first, then all of what I mentioned is not waste. You see? While you are sleeping, you will be rewarded. While you are eating, you will be rewarded. While you are having fun, like the brother said, you will be rewarded. But where you cannot do all of this while a person is not praying and fasting and doing nafl and everything. He said, amal is ibadah, sheikh. Start with the original ibadah first. You have to start with the original ibadah. But what I'm trying to, the point I'm trying to make, sometimes we think that we are doing the actual ibadat, and we see the percentage, find it less than 1% of our life. You want also to say that I am doing 2 hours of ibadah every day between Quran and the deen and the learning. Like this hour counts. Like you staying here 1.5 hour every Sunday morning, that counts for learning. You know how you are going to make your work for earning good without dedicating sometimes actually for ibadah. And then everything becomes ibadah after because you're learning that as well. So the Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, the best of you is the one who have longer life and good deeds. So may Allah, whenever you give somebody dua for long life, may Allah give you long life in his obedience. See the dua? May Allah give you long life for his obedience. Beautiful dua, right? Assalamu alaikum. May Allah give you long life for his obedience, subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah make you long life with his service, subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's a beautiful dua. Whenever you want to make dua for someone with long life, add that portion of obedience of Allah. May Allah give you longer life fi sabilillah. Remember, whenever you give longer life fi sabilillah. May Allah give you longer life with his ta'a. May Allah give you longer life with his ibadah. May Allah give you longer life and husn al-amal. Always add the portion that long life which is worthy. We just don't want long life doing what? Long life for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I mentioned the hadith for you, the hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari, that Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, being good to your rahim, to your kin, will increase your life and give you barakah in the rizq. Sometimes, ya akhwani, we think our family members would be a reason to decrease our rizq. Huh? Actually, it is the opposite. You know, be good to your family members, inshallah, it will increase your rizq. Especially when they are good people. They are not bad people. They are not jealous from you. They are not backbiting. They are not doing bad things. Even if they are like that and you do some kind of ihsan, Allah Azza Jal give you barakah as well. But if your family are good people and you are helping them, it will never decrease your rizq. Wallahi will give barakah in your rizq. It will give barakah in your rizq. Subhanallah. And the increase in the children and in the money can be good and can be bad. If you are a believer, it is good. If you're not a believer, it's not. And the Quran says that. أَيَحْسَبُونَ أَنَّمَا نُمِدُّهُمْ بِهِ مِنْ مَالٍ وَبَنِينَ نُسَارِعُ لَهُمْ فِي الْخَيْرَاتِ بَلْ لَا يَشْعُرُونَ وَلَا يَحْسَبَنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا أَنَّمَا نُمْلِي لَهُمْ خَيْرٌ لِأَنفُسِهِمْ إِنَّمَا نُمْلِي لَهُمْ لِيَزْدَادُوا إِثْمًا وَلَهُمْ عَذَابٌ مُهِينٌ. Don't let the disbelievers think we are increasing in their wealth and their children because we like them. No. Or it is good for them. No, we are increasing this, so punishment becomes more. So a believer is rewarded for eating, but a disbeliever is punished for eating. Because this eating leads to obey, this eating leads to disobey. You see, that's why Rasulullah even said, intimate relationship, you are rewarded for it, because you are using it to reach to Allah Azza Jal, but this one is not. Then you could do the same thing, but one is rewarded for it, and one is not. That is where your life becomes, you know, ibadah and all of that. You would be rewarded for everything you do, but you have to start with sincere intention and ibadah to Allah. So we stop here, inshallah, Rabbil Alameen. May Allah give us long life with his ibadah. May Allah give us long life for serving his cause. May Allah protect our children and our spouses. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us among those who listen and follow the best of what they listen to. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa barak ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen.